600 cases of tuberculosis last year, a 16% increase over the year before, and the highest level in a decade. Experts say there's also been a global surge in cases with increases in migration and post-pandemic international travel. But other factors are being studied. They could include COVID and other infections that weaken the immune system and allow latent tuberculosis infections to emerge. TB is caused by bacteria that usually attack the lungs and is spread through the air when an infectious person coughs or sneezes. I'm Jackie Quinn.
Breaking news and analysis, townhall.com.
On Point Weather is made possible by our friends at Palmetto Citizens Federal Credit Union on 107 The Point.
Here's our weekend forecast. You can't ask for much nicer than this. Clear and cool tonight with a low of 48. Tomorrow, really nice. Mostly sunny skies, a temperature climbing to 79. For Sunday, hunt those Easter eggs. 83 as our high and a blend of sunshine and clouds. Looking ahead, we're dry until Wednesday of next week. Have a great weekend. I'm Cal Moss with your Odd Point local weather.
WQXL Columbia, W264DF.
Grills, outdoor kitchens, and fireplaces. Spring sizzle starts with Bart.
This is 107 The Point.
Come on, hit it. Do it. You know you want to.
This is Sports Talk with Phil Kornblum, Chris Bergen, and Pat Daniel. Sports Talk is heard across the state on radio affiliates of the Sports Talk Media Network and is streaming live on sportstalksc.com, as well as Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. The South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number to call in is 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now, here are Phil, Chris, and Pat with tonight's edition of Sports Talk.
All right, welcome in, everybody, and happy Good Friday to you as we come to you from the Sports Talk Media Network on this beautiful afternoon in South Carolina. Hope you've had a great day, and we're very happy to be with you on this Friday to wrap up a busy week. Well, Clemson Tigers, Elite Eight, one win away from the Final Four. Chris Bergen, I hearken back to 2017 as South Carolina was making their run. And every game it was like, I can't believe they did that. And then it was, I can't believe they did that. Well, same thing here with Clemson. I can't believe what I'm seeing. I mean, I know this team had moments in the regular season where they played extremely well, and they had moments in the regular season where they did not play well at all. And then they lose in the first round of the ACC tournament, and everybody said, well, they're barely going to get into the NCAA tournament, and they'll be quickly eliminated. They are just playing fantastic basketball. They are being well-coached. They are carrying out coaches' orders, and they're playing excellent basketball. They're playing connected basketball, looking for one another. The timeout that Brownell called with 9 seconds to go on the shot clock on that late possession last night, and then they run a play coming off that timeout, and they get a layup. That really kind of stemmed the tide at that particular point because Arizona had come back, and it was a tight ball game. That says it all right there in my mind. Brownell coaching his butt off, Players following his lead and executing. And what you got now are three wins in games where you were underdog and you have taken three teams that live with a three-point shot and live with fast-paced, high-scoring offenses and pretty much nullified what they do best. And we saw that early last night. I thought early in that game last night, Clemson had that game right where they wanted it to be, pace-wise, playing the way they wanted to play. I know they built the lead, and then Arizona came back, tied it, actually took a brief lead. But I really felt like, and they've done this in all three games, they've taken control of the games in the first 5 minutes, and they've led like 99% of the minutes of those three games combined. Very impressive.
I thought they were tremendous last night. And you brought up a point last evening on the show about the previous two games. And you said that Brad Brownell had outcoached his opponents. I think you can add number three to the list last night. I thought he was terrific, especially shifting defenses in the second half. He talked about going man-to-man against Arizona, and they were getting into foul trouble in a hurry. So he went back to the zone, and the Wildcats never figured out a way to solve it. And, Phil, I'm all in on the Tigers now. Hmm. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, third time, shame on me. I could give you all the reasons on paper why New Mexico could have beaten them, why Baylor should have beaten them, and why Arizona could have beaten them last night. But that does not calculate team playing together, as you pointed out, and a team playing defense the way Clemson is right now. And I think tomorrow, of the four matchups they've had in the NCAA tournament thus far, with Alabama on the horizon tomorrow, I think that's the best matchup for them of the previous three. I mean, they could not have asked for it to work out any better tomorrow. I think they beat Alabama just the way they did the first time, and that's hold the game and defend Alabama, because the Crimson Tide, they have no interest, as you saw last night, in playing defense in a wild game with North Carolina. But when those two teams met back early in the season in Tuscaloosa, Alabama shot 34% from the field, and Clemson shot 53% from the field. Clemson takes better shots. They take care of the basketball, and they play good defense. I think they're on their way to Phoenix, just like the Gamecocks were back in 2017.
You know, and it's just amazing, too, how tied in South Carolina, Clemson are to Glendale, Arizona. Because if Clemson wins Saturday, they go to Glendale, which is a suburb of Phoenix, to play in the big dome there where the Cardinals play. Same place the Gamecocks played in the Final Four in 17. Same place where the Clemson football team played Alabama for the national championship in 2016 and lost in a high-scoring game. If I'm not mistaken, they played one other time. Might have been a semifinal in that building and won. I think I recall being there. I know I was there for a Clemson playoff game, and they won it. So I'm thinking that might have been, was that the year that they, did they play in Glendale and then go to Tampa? Is that how that went? They won in Glendale and then went to Tampa? I have to go back and check.
Because their two national championships, the games that they won are actually in, what, San Francisco and Tampa, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
So, and also, speaking of the football team and the tie-in there, does Dabo cancel next weekend's spring game? So he can, and the football staff can go watch the Tigers and go support Brad Brownell and those guys, or do they move the spring game to Friday so they can get on a plane and hop out and head out to Phoenix? Because, you know, they know all the hot spots. Should be pretty easy for them to get in there.
Neither. They'll play their game at the regular time. They got a bunch of recruits coming in. Keep in mind, we don't know if they'll play in the 6 o'clock game if they make it there. We don't know if they'll play in the 6 o'clock game or the 9 o'clock game. I'm sure they'll turn Death Valley into a viewing arena.
That'd be awesome.
Fans
stay
and
watch.
They
did last night at Little John, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
I've never seen something correctly. They turned Little John in. And quite frankly, I think they'll probably get the early game, don't you? Because you're looking at on the other side, you're going to get Connecticut coming out. They're not on the same side of the bracket with the Huskies, are they?
God, I
can't remember how the thing works out.
I'd have to look and see.
Yep.
2019, Clemson played in Glendale in the Fiesta Bowl. In the playoffs against Ohio State. And they won that game, 29-23. And that's when they went and played LSU for the national championship and
gotcha,
got beat.
Yep.
Yeah. So the Glendale has a place in the hearts of Clemson and Gamecock fans. We're going to go to Los Angeles right now. Nate Oates of Alabama is talking at the press conference. Let's bring you a couple of minutes of him, and then in our next half hour, we'll have the Clemson team will be talking at about 6:40, and we'll bring that to you live as well. So we're going to go to Nate Oates here in just a moment, head coach of the Crimson Tide, listening to what he has to say. Well, I think we're going to do that here in just a moment. In the meantime, I'll tell you that USC women running it up on Indiana 49-32 in their Sweet 16 game in Albany, New York. The Gamecocks are shooting 51%. They're 5 of 8 from 3. Indiana, 38%. 6 of 17 from 3. The Gamecocks are 8 of 9 from the line. They've turned it over 5 times. Indiana's turned it over 9 times. And the Gamecocks have turned that into 15 points off those turnovers. USC is winning in the paint 24-10. Cardoso has 13 points, 3 rebounds to lead the Gamecocks. Hall has 8 points at this point. And so the Gamecocks, a little tight there in the first quarter, Chris, but then they had about a 10 or 12 point spurt, and they put some separation between themselves and the Hoosiers.
They do what they do, and they're holding Indiana, one of the best field goal shooting teams in the nation, to just 38%. They came in shooting over 50% for the season, and bench points, again, critically important. Carolina's outscoring them 18-2 off the bench. Indiana's just not deep enough to stay with the Gamecocks. They're going to have to knock down probably 10 three-pointers in the second half to have any chance, but it looks like the Gamecocks are going to cruise into the Elite Eight, where they'll face Oregon State, surprisingly enough, who won earlier today. So that's who the Gamecocks will get. And by the way, back to Clemson real quickly, they are on the same side of the bracket as UConn. Mm. So if the Huskies get into the Final Four, my guess is Clemson will play the nightcap because they'd want to profile UConn, don't you think? Or would they pick them early?
Yeah. No, yeah. I think they'd play the second game. Mm-hmm. I think they would. Let's go to Nate Oates now. He's talking at the press conference in L.A. about his team and the Tigers. Let's listen in. Nate Oates for a couple of minutes, the Alabama coach.
One that I'm probably glad that we played them early so our players have some idea of the physicality and how good their bigs are, because their bigs hurt us a lot inside, and their guards hurt us too. I mean, we didn't do a good job taking away their best players. I thought, Hall and Gerard and Hunter all got off on us pretty good the first time.
Go to the third row. Get a mic over to you.
Katie Mendham from Bama Central. Talking to the players a little bit about whether they view this as a revenge game. Aaron said, as a competitor, that's part of it. Is that something you're using as motivation for this game, or is being the first team to get to the Final Four in program history motivation enough?
I mean, we'll use whatever we can at this point, whatever we think resonates with our players. But I think as a competitor, if you've got some pride, got embarrassed on your home court earlier in the year and you got a chance to redeem it on a neutral floor, I'd think that'd be a little extra motivation for you right there. But, Clemson's also trying to make their first Final Four. They're going to be extra motivated. So we can't just rely on being motivated, because the other team's going to be motivated too. We got to be locked into a scouting report, focused, detail-oriented, things that we've been good at here in the tournament that maybe we lacked during the course of the year at different times.
We'll keep it in the third row.
Josh Peter with USA Today. I was asking the players about the strong finishes you guys have had the last two games and what's allowed you to do it. And Ryland pointed out it's not what happened to the non-conference schedule. And sort of learn from that. What has your team learned? How have you been able to put it together the last two games?
Yeah, we try to talk through, what do we learn from every game? And I talk to our players if we got here late before the NCAA tournament started, like what have we learned, like from the losses particularly? Like, they're not failures if you learn from them. There's lots of things in life that don't go the way you want them to go, and if you learn from it, it can be a win even if it was a lost moment. So, one of the big things was our last 12 minutes of the games, we weren't good in the non-conference. We were tired. We made bad decisions. We folded. We collapsed. So, I took that timeout, about 8 minutes. We had the media timeout shortly after that. Both those timeouts, I think the energy was like we got to go now. Now, we still ended up being down. They made a little run there. RJ Davis got going a little bit, and they took the lead. I thought our guys showed a lot of resilience. And we talked to them about sometimes you're going to do things right, and the other team's going to make tough shots, and you just got to go to the next play. So, let's quit dwelling on it, not feel sorry for ourselves. Let's go to the next play. The last play should have no impact on the next play, and I think we've done a pretty good job moving on to the next play, especially at the end of games, just figuring out a way to get some wins.
We'll go to Jordan here in the second row.
Jordan Mendoza, USA Today. You're at a school that's always going to be associated with football, with the amount of success it's had on the football field. You've mentioned that we have a chance to go to the first Final Four in school history, and also this is your second Elite Eight ever in school history. What does this moment mean for Alabama basketball, and what could it mean to go to its first Final Four?
Yeah, we got two schools like that here, right? Alabama and Clemson playing in L.A. Most people think of playing a Rose Bowl out here probably, right? So the basketball Rose Bowl. I think it'd be huge, because we came in and Alabama football is obviously best football program in the country over the course of college football. In my opinion, they've got all kinds of national championships, but it's been, you know, multiple sports have won national championships at Alabama. The athletic department as a whole is a championship level athletic department, and we need to get men's basketball up to the level that a lot of other sports are at. So, you know, if you could make, you know, the Final Four, obviously winning the national championship's the biggest thing, but the Final Four is huge, men's basketball. So if you get to a Final Four and kind of put yourself on that stage, I think we've been able to recruit some high-level players. Players want to play here. We've won two SEC regular seasons, two SEC tournaments since we've been here. We've won a lot, but we've never been to a Final Four.
All right, that's Nate Oates live from Los Angeles. They're having the press conferences for the remaining two teams there. They'll meet tomorrow night about 8:49 or so, I think it is, Eastern time. The Tigers will be in about 20 minutes or so, 20, 25 minutes. We're going to clear our docket so we can bring that to you between 6:35 and 7 o'clock, and we'll be right back.
I'm attorney Jim Corbett. That's the sound of a big hit on you and your car or truck. I've been an attorney for more than 30 years, helping people who get injured in car wrecks and truck wrecks. If you have serious injuries, call Jim Corbett, 803-765-2968, or email me at jim@jimcorbettattorney.com. That's C-O-R-B-E-T-T. I don't get paid unless I recover for you. Jim Corbett Attorney, for your best recovery from a big hit, 803-765-2968, or jim@jimcorbettattorney.com.
Stay tuned. More Sports Talk is coming up on the Sports Talk Media Network.
Every lottery ticket purchase keeps education in our state moving forward. In fact, the lottery has raised more than $200 million for state school buses to get our students to school safely every day. Then, the lottery helps those students go even further in their education by funding the Life, Hope, and Palmetto Fellow Scholarships. So remember, when you play the lottery, you're keeping South Carolina students on the road to success. Learn more at sceducationlottery.com/betteryou.
George Bryan here for Tsunami Bar Sports, and some say the fun is in the winning. I say the fun is in the training. And Tsunami Robbie, what do you say?
George, we all know you get more done when you're having fun. This technology is different, it's engaging, but it's also a lot of fun to use.
Hi, this is Phil Kornblut. Be sure to click on the digital ad on sportstalksc.com and get 5% off any Tsunami Bar order using promo code BBB5. Don't wait, order today. Okay, we're back on Sports Talk, Sports Talk Media Network on this Friday night. 888-898-2525 is the number. 61-48, South Carolina on top of Indiana. Media timeout in the third quarter. An 8-0 run by Indiana over the last 148. It's kind of gotten them back in this thing a little bit, and they've hit each of their last six field goal attempts. 61-48, USC women. Braves win today in their season opener in Philadelphia, 9-3. It was delayed, of course, by rain by a day. So the Braves get off on the winning foot, 9-13-0. Johnson gets the win, 3-5-1 for the Phillies. So the Braves expecting to be outstanding again this season, and they flex some muscles here to open the season. Of course, it's only the opening game, Chris. You know that you can't judge a team by its opening game win, unless you're the Yankees.
Unless they're the Yankees, and on Thursday, when they're now going for 162-0.
Yes, yes. Braves were down 2-0 in this one early on, but obviously, I say early on, fifth inning they were down 2-0. Phillies scored two in the fifth. Braves tied it in the seventh, then scored seven runs in the eighth inning to turn this game in their direction. So. Good start for Atlanta. Other baseball this afternoon, as some teams are opening their seasons today, besides the Braves and the Phillies. Let's see what else we've got here as far as final scores. The Mets lose to Milwaukee 3-1. They almost had a brawl in that game. A little dust up at second base, empty the dugouts and the bullpens. So Milwaukee beat the Mets 3-1. Atlanta beat the Phillies 9-3. And that's it for the games that have been played so far this afternoon. What you got?
I said certainly a good way to get the season going, get into a fight in game one.
Why wait? You know, this had something to do with a player from the Brewers that had a little bit of history with the Mets. And he went in hard at second base to try to break up a double play. And the Mets second baseman took exception to it because he got his spikes into his leg. Could have been a very serious injury, but he avoided that. But he got up off the dirt and was chomping at the Brewers player, and he was mouthing back. And, of course, both dugouts emptied. But in typical baseball fashion, nothing happened. You know, they didn't mix it up or anything like that. I love right. when the guys in the bullpen come trotting in like, okay, here comes the cavalry from 200 yards away to try to help do something. But nothing happened, and there were no ejections, and everything turned out to be fine after a few minutes. We got baseball tonight. South Carolina continues their series at Alabama. Tough loss for the Gamecocks last night, 4-3, a game they led 3-1. They gave up the winning run in the eighth inning on a wild pitch, and they left some base runners on base with a chance to win that ball game or extend their lead. Couldn't get it done, so they lose the opener. Eli Jones was really good for the Gamecocks last night. Gainey was not when he came in, and he took the loss. And Clemson loses a tough one last night at Miami. 3-2, a low-scoring game there. So these teams will be playing again tonight, getting underway here in just a little bit. Let's go to the phones, 888-898-2525. Tiger Bryan. Beg your pardon?
Aren't you going to do recruiting here?
No, we're going to do it after the bottom of the hour.
Ah, gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, sorry. I think I threw Josh off with that. We'll do it after the bottom of the hour. Let's go to Tiger Bryan, standing by with us here on Sports Talk. Tiger Bryan, welcome in on this Good Friday. How are you?
Man, it's a great day to be a Tiger fan.
Yeah.
And, hey, and I was 1 point off of my prediction last night, was it not?
Were you? Was he
yes,
1 point off?
He said they win by four.
I predicted we'd
they
beat
won
him
by
four.
Yep.
You are amazing. The
no,
things
I'm
that
not.
Things
I'm
that
just,
go on
I'm
in
just,
that in that fertile brain of yours.
No, Cohen, I'm just a simple man.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. I'm like Charlie Daniels. I'm a simple man.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, hey, you know, you tell Gamecock Larry, I hope he's listening. You know, he's talking junk about gonna give me 10 points and all that. Tell him I'll give him 5 points in Alabama.
Whoa.
Tell him I'll give him 5 points. We're going to beat him by eight.
Now, wait a second. Now that you bring it up, didn't Gamecock Larry give me Clemson and 10 points last night?
He did.
For a half
he
of his.
He also said it was going to be 3-0 after last night.
Yeah.
Gamecock baseball win, Carolina women's, which was probably going to be the only one he got right.
Mm-hmm.
And then Clemson lost. Probably should take more projections and predictions from Tiger Bryan than we do from Gamecock Larry.
I think Gamecock Larry was wagering half of his estate, half of his everything he stashed away. So I'm going to have to go collect on that. That's a good pickup by the coin right there. I took those 10 points. If he wants to call up and give 10 more points, I'll take those as well. But seriously, Tiger Bryan, as a Clemson fan as you are, lifelong, lifetime, can you kind of believe what you're seeing out of your basketball team?
It beats anything I ever seen in my life. You know what I mean? I was junior high school last time they got this far.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Well, I tell you, it's something exciting for a fan base like it was for the Gamecocks to do something that's totally unexpected. Because, look, it's not like they were a top two or three seed. They were a six seed. And as I recall, I believe the Gamecocks, Chris, weren't they a seven seed in 2017?
Yep, they were a
seven
seed.
So, I mean,
this is
not expected. And you like to see a team and a coach and everybody come together and just play as one. That's what they're doing. They're playing as one to this point. Can they keep it going one more game? I mean – you getting to the Final Four is the thing. I mean, winning the national championship is the ultimate. Getting to the Final Four, though, would be quite an accomplishment. You just got to get over this last hurdle.
Yeah, but you know, I'm a Tiger fan. Like I said, they're my Cinderella team. Normally, I have a Cinderella team. You know, make one that don't come like you said, come out 10 or 12 seeds, you know, and get up there to the Sweet 16.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, it's been that long since I've had this much excitement for my basketball team.
Yeah. Probably never have had this kind of excitement. Well, I guess you go back to the last time that they got to the Elite Eight, and that was in, what, 1980, I think it was?
1980, yeah. I graduated high school in 81. That was 1980, and I was excited then. And ever since then, I ain't really got excited. I mean, I pull for all my every sport, don't get me wrong, but – yeah, we just ain't never been this close. We ain't never. This team, Corn, they playing together and they believe in themselves. You know, just like I believe in y'all guys. Sport talk rules, man.
All right. Thank you, Tiger Bryan. We appreciate you, man. Good hearing from you. Have a good weekend. Enjoy that basketball game tomorrow night and everything else going on. And we'll be back. We'll bring you recruiting. And if the timing works out for us, we'll bring you Clemson from Los Angeles. Be back in a moment.
On Point Weather is made possible by our friends at Palmetto Citizens Federal Credit Union on 107 The Point.
Here's our weekend forecast. You can't ask for much nicer than this. Clear and cool tonight with a low of 48. Tomorrow, really nice. Mostly sunny skies, a temperature climbing to 79. For Sunday, hunt those Easter eggs. 83 as our high and a blend of sunshine and clouds. Looking ahead, we're dry until Wednesday of next week. Have a great weekend. I'm Cal Moss with your Odd Point local weather.
Hey, y'all, this is Ted from Flight Deck Restaurant. We'd like to invite you and your family to dine with us. We have a great menu that's sure to please your whole family. We have fresh-cooked burgers, big juicy wings, blue plate menu featuring country cooking, oven-baked hoagies, fresh, crisp salads, authentic Greek food like gyros, souvlaki, and baklava. We also carry 20 different premium cheesecakes and pies. Flight Deck Restaurant also has an arcade with 30 different games like Star Wars, Batman, Skee-Ball, Bass Wheel, Pac-Man, Galaga, and so much more. Flight Deck, your favorite family restaurant. Thanks, y'all, and God bless.
With SRN News, I'm Jason Walker. The collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Maryland proving to be a monumental challenge. Maryland Governor Wes Moore says 4 huge cranes will help in the recovery effort. In the meantime, experts say the reconstruction of the bridge could cost hundreds of millions of dollars. This is beginning to get a little bit scary now. OpenAI unveiling a new voice engine technology. It can clone a person's voice after hearing it for just 14, 15 seconds. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says Israel will return to the table for ceasefire talks with Hamas. Part of the deal, a number of Israeli hostages would be released. In South Africa, a bus carrying worshipers to an Easter weekend gathering has plunged off a bridge. At least 45 people have been killed. This is SRN News.
I was thinking about the things that matter to me when it comes to calling the plumber. First, most of us call the plumber out of a need, often a crisis. So you want reliability. Then, we're in a vulnerable place already, so you want someone you can trust, someone who will be fair in their pricing and handle things professionally. These are some of the reasons I feel comfortable recommending Franklin Plumbing and Drain Cleaning. See, they've been out to my home. They've been out to my brother's home, too. Franklin Plumbing and Drain Cleaning did such a great job. And you know, maybe this might not matter as much to some people, but they're locally owned. A lot of these plumbing companies you've heard of used to be local, and now they're owned by big national or even international conglomerates. Working with a locally owned company matters. It keeps your pricing down, and the money stays local here in the community. Josh and his team at Franklin makes customer service their top priority. I trust them. You can too, especially during these vulnerable times. Online, it's franklinplumbingsc.com, or call them 799-2222. That's 799-2222.
At Palmetto State Armory, we offer the largest selection of guns and ammunition at unbeatable prices. Our knowledgeable and friendly staff are here to provide personalized assistance, ensuring you find exactly what you need. If you enjoy outdoor activities like hunting, camping, or hiking, our clothing and outdoor gear collection has got you covered. We also feature an exceptional indoor range facility where you can experience the thrill of shooting in a safe and controlled environment. Visit us today at PalmettoStateArmory.com or your local retail store. Palmetto State Armory, American made for life.
Dave Ramsey here. Do you want your money to work for you rather than you working for your money? Go see my friends at Palmetto Citizens Federal Credit Union. They're not a mega bank and have been serving the Midlands since 1936, offering good old-fashioned customer service and free services. They'll look out for your financial well-being. With 14 locations, check them out today at palmettocitizens.org. Federally insured by the NCUA.
Great things don't happen all at once. Big dreams take time. And when it comes to saving for college, it's those small steps that make a difference. I'm State Treasurer Curtis Loftus. Future Scholar, South Carolina's 529 College Savings Plan is designed to be taken step by step. You can start with any amount, contributions are tax deductible, and earnings grow tax free. So why wait? Discover the smart, easy way to save for college at futurescholar.com.
Paid for by official funds authorized by the House of Representatives.
Hello, this is Congressman Ralph Norman. It is my greatest honor to serve the people of South Carolina's 5th Congressional District. If my office can ever be of any help with any federal issues such as VA, IRS, Social Security, passports, and many others, please give us a call at 803-327-1114 or stop by our office in Rock Hill. For more information about our offices, please visit norman.house.gov. Thank you so much.
Listen. Okay, we continue, and we'll dive into the recruiting report while we wait for the Clemson players and Coach Brownell to get to the press conference room in Los Angeles, and we're going to bring you as much of that as we can. Mike Morgan at 7:05, he'll join us. Mike has a good feel for this game. He's seen a lot of Alabama, and he's seen Clemson. He's been watching the tournament, so he'll share his insights. Jeff Owens on NASCAR coming up, and George Brian III on golf at 7:35. Birdies, bogeys, and biceps around to South Carolina. A lot of college golf to talk about. On to recruiting, and our recruiting is brought to you by Seawells. Wrapped up another big week of the daily luncheon buffet at Seawells. You can't find a buffet anywhere, not in Los Angeles, not in Chicago, not in New York, that tops the Seawells Daily Luncheon Buffet for only $14.50. You eat as much as you want. You have a lot of space to eat. Great desserts, all the iced tea that you want. So make sure you make plans to get over to Seawells next week for the Daily Luncheon Buffet, 11 till 2. And for the best in the catering business, that also is Seawells. And their phone number is 803-771-7385. Online at SeawellsCateringSC.com. One of Clemson's top offensive line targets, offensive tackle Mason Short of Evans, Georgia, plans to announce his college decision next Friday, according to Chad Simmons of On3. Simmons wrote that Short has his decision down to Clemson, Georgia, though Short also lists Kentucky, Ohio State among his finalists. He has visited Clemson and Georgia twice each this year. He was at Clemson Junior Day, January 27th, spring practice, March 13th. Feeling by Paul Strelo of Tiger Illustrated is that he's going to Georgia. So that pretty much sums that up. Looks like Clemson's going to miss on another major target. So either they got out-recruited or they got out-spent, depending on how you want to spin it. Wide receiver Derek Meadows, 6'5", 200, Las Vegas, has set an official visit to USC May 31st per Hale McGranahan, Big Spur. He visited Notre Dame unofficially earlier this week. He's a national-level recruit, 15 catches, 391 yards, 8 touchdowns last season. USC's in the top 12. Linebacker Tavian Wallace, Jessup, Georgia. The others are Arkansas, Kentucky, Florida, Auburn, LSU, Florida State, Tennessee, Louisville, Georgia, Michigan, Missouri. He has officials to Georgia, June 7th, USC June 21st. He was at USC last year for a spring practice, back in July for the cookout, and he was at a spring practice last Saturday. He also visited LSU this month and is scheduled to visit Florida State April 12th. Of course, his brother plays at Alabama. South Carolina, though, has got a really good shot to get him at this point. Irmo quarterback A.J. Brand was offered by Virginia Tech today while on a visit. 2026 offensive tackle Scotland Dover, 6'4", 308 of Gaffney, was in for a visit to USC Thursday. He has offers from Appalachian State and Coastal Carolina. Basketball, USC this weekend hosting 6'8", E.J. Walker, Erlanger, Kentucky, for an official. He and his parents coming in for the visit. It will be his first to South Carolina. He said Lamont Paris and the staff started recruiting him after the AAU season. Paris came in to see him, and they've stayed on him pretty hard. He averaged 17-11 this past season, and they like his versatility. Paris has told him he could play a number of different ways for him because he is so versatile. He's also going to set officials to Purdue, Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Ohio State. He's been to Tennessee and to Wisconsin, Xavier, and Purdue for various visits. Also this weekend, the Big Spur reported, Furman transfer guard J.P. Pegues will take an official to USC. Three seasons in Greenville, one season of eligibility left. This season, 18 points, 5 assists, 4 rebounds per game. USC's in the final six with UT Martin transfer 5'11 Jordan Sears. He also has Alabama, LSU, West Virginia, Texas Tech, and Arizona State on his short list, according to Joe Tipton of On3. I don't believe he's related to the Sears who plays, unless they're cousins. He's not a brother of the Sears who plays at Alabama based on his bio. He began his career at Gardner-Webb, where he played two seasons before transferring to UTM 2 years ago. This season, averaged nearly 22 points, 5 assists, 5 rebounds per game. Columbia native K.J. Green has reopened his recruiting after getting his release from UCF. He had drawn some recruiting interest from USC and Clemson prior to his commitment to the Knights last October. He took officials last fall to Georgetown, Siena, and UCF. Coastal Carolina landed 7'2", Missouri transfer center Mabor Majak. He averaged less than a point and 1.5 rebounds per game this season, but he will look good coming off the bus at 7'2".
No doubt.
Work on that name too, Chris. Mabor Majak. And former Clemson women's commitment Imari Berry, their top recruit who decommitted, recently took an official visit to Louisville, according to 94 Feet WBB. That's recruiting brought to you by our good friends at Seawells. Now to L.A., here is Brad Brownell at the beginning of his press conference.
This accomplishment, happy for our players. These guys have been unbelievable to coach all year, certainly Chase and PJ have been with me for a long time. So very rewarding to get to this point, but don't want to stop now. I think we're a hungry group that is playing really good basketball. We know we have a terrific opponent in Alabama. They played fantastic last night and beat a really good Chapel Hill team. So we have our hands full, but we're excited for the opportunity.
All right. We'll open up for questions for the student athletes. Start here in the front.
Hey, PJ, Facts and Childress, 105.5 The Roar. Can you just talk a little bit about the magnitude of this moment, you know, being a premier player on a team headed to their second Elite Eight in program history, and then obviously the local ties going to Dorman High School growing up in the state of South Carolina?
Yeah, I mean, it's really cool, obviously. But, you know, growing up, I was never like a huge, you know, like basketball or sports watcher, so I didn't realize the magnitude of, you know, what it would mean to a community to get to a spot like this and have the opportunity to go to the first Final Four of the school. But, you know, now that I'm here and seeing how much excitement there is back home, it's incredible the support we have, and it really speaks to the culture of Clemson and the culture of the community around there. It's a special place to play and a place to go to school. And you know, like I said, man, it's incredible.
We'll go next to Jordan over here.
Jordan Mendoza, USA Today Sports. This question can be for any of you guys. Alabama's talked about, they wanted to make the adjustments from what they saw in the first matchup they played against you guys. When you guys are going over, trying to talk about, the strategy for tomorrow, what are kind of some things you guys are trying to focus on so you guys can not only beat them again, but advance to your first Final Four?
I think for us, it's kind of the same. Coaches talked to us a little bit since we found out that's who we were playing against. That, they're kind of a completely different team than they were when we played them earlier, and so are we. So, but obviously, there's advantages and disadvantages that you had in the first game that you can use. But again, it's March now, and that was back in November, December. So it's completely different teams, but at the same time, you just got to go in there, follow the game plan, and make sure you do what you do.
We'll go to the fourth row. For any of the players, Jonah Krell, Arizona PBS. Last night, your win against Arizona was your 12th win away from home, which set a school record. I'm just curious, and it was a pretty heavy Arizona crowd. For you guys' mindset, which is, what is it about those atmospheres that gets you guys up to play? Joseph, we'll begin with you.
Sorry. Playing away from home is a lot of fun, for me personally. I know these guys as well, especially with such an older group, you're kind of used to those environments. But at the same time, you kind of thrive in them. Obviously, we love playing at home, love playing Little John in front of the fans, and it's a lot of fun. But sometimes when you can go on the road and play in a hostile environment, it gets you kind of juices flowing a little bit even more. It gets you fired up. So, last night was almost like an away game for us, like you said. And we were just ready to go, fired up from the beginning. And had the mindset that we were going to go in there and try and keep the crowd as quiet as we could.
Anything to add, please? All right. Anybody else have any questions in the room here? We'll go next to the front row right here.
John Blau, the Post and Courier Chase. I remember talking to you in the preseason about just conditioning and wanting to kind of take that to another level, the ladder drills and all that.
Yeah.
The way you've been able to play late in the season, do you think it has anything to do with kind of upping that and being able to finish late in games?
Yeah, I would definitely give credit to conditioning. We did a lot of stuff this summer that, was kind of strenuous on us. And I think it kind of prepared us for the season. And then, when you're just playing throughout the season, you kind of get more conditioned as the season goes. And now that we're in the later half of the season, my conditioning definitely picked up and allowed me to, play through full games.
Gary Carter, Greenville News. Joe, it wasn't your best shooting night last night, but you were able to impact the game with your passing and playmaking. What does that speak to for you to, even though you're kind of known as being a shooter, that you're able to get the offense flowing and, get the offense flowing?
Just got a lot of great players around me. These guys make my job so much easier. If I can draw two defenders sometimes, whether it's off the ball or on the ball, and I know I got a lot of other four great players who are out there who can put the ball in the hoop, it's a pretty easy job. So, it's kind of selling an all tournament, and I think it's helped us out a lot. I think that's why we're having so much success. But at the same time, the other four guys out there are pretty good as well, and know how to put the ball in the basket. So it's a pretty easy game when it's 4-4.
Go ahead.
PJ, how do you not make this game bigger than it is, though? Obviously, to have such a huge opportunity to get to a Final Four, how do you mentally focus yourself to not make it too big?
Yeah, for me, it's funny. I was talking to our mental performance coach last night about that. Whenever I'm out on the court, I really don't feel the magnitude of a game, whether it's, in the Dean Dome or at Cameron Indoor or anything like that. Whenever I'm out on the court, it feels like I'm just playing, especially in a game like this. Whenever you're back home watching March Madness, you feel this is the Elite Eight. This is a big game. But when you're out there going up and down the court, you're really just playing. And, the crowds aren't insane. It's not a true road game. It's an incredible environment. But being able to know that you're just out there playing ball and keeping calm, that's the best way to go out there and continue to just have a steady pace.
If you have a question here in the room, make sure to raise your hand. We'll get a mic over. Go in the back. Go ahead.
Don Munson, Clemson Radio. This is for PJ, all the three players. Describe to me the relationship that you have with Coach Brownell, because each of you
Sports Talk, we're listening to the live press conference, Clemson players and Coach Brad Brownell out in Los Angeles. Meantime, up in Albany, 69-62, the USC women lead Indiana 450 to play. Back out to LA with the Clemson men.
you know, things didn't go as well for me, but, you know, battled through some injuries, and, you know, he was there by my side the whole time. And, you know, I think that, you know, through these 5 years, I've learned a lot from him, whereas X and O's on the court, off the court stuff. And we built this big relationship, and, you know, now that we're here, it's crazy. You know, it feels surreal to be in this moment after 5 years to go through everything that we did. And, yeah, but no, I appreciate Coach for everything he's done for me. And he's taught me a lot about the game.
I think for me, obviously, it's a lot different than these guys. You know, I've built a really great relationship with him, and it was pretty fast. And, you know, in the transfer portal, I was obviously looking for, you know, a good team that I could go to where I could make a run, but also wanted to go somewhere that I'd have a relationship with the coach for, you know, not just a year, but, you know, for the rest of my life. And that was the guy that, you know, I put my trust in, and he put his trust in me as well. And it's been nothing short. And, you know, I'll know that I'll talk to Coach Brownell for forever and have a lot of faith in, you know, what he does for me on and off the court, because obviously he's made me a better player, but, you know, a better person as well.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat with Chase of how long I've been here with him. You know, also with me, I've battled some injuries and didn't play much my freshman year either. So it wasn't necessarily came in here, it was right away making an impact. And so having that support from him for the last 4 years, it was always there, and I always knew it. It was made it known. And it's funny, we're on two opposite ends of the spectrum of detail oriented and how we go about things. And so it's funny, like, you have that, but also we're right next to each other and being competitive and ready to go out there and fight. And so that dynamic is really funny. And you see that in the game, like when he's up in my face and I'm out there trying to get the crowd going, he's trying to calm me down. It's definitely a yin and yang, but it's special. And it was, I mean, coming to Clemson and playing for him is something I would never change, you know.
But fourth row back there.
Yeah, Chase, out of the Kalmbach, Arizona PBS. Just kind of take me through, like, what was it like seeing your younger brother get that crucial steal at the end of the game with the and one?
Yeah, it was definitely big. I think a big moment for our family. You know, I looked in the crowd, looked at my mom, and, you know, she was going crazy up there. But, yeah, definitely a surreal moment. You know, seeing the videos and stuff, it's just crazy, you know, to be in this moment, to be in the Sweet 16 with my little brother, and he makes sort of the game-winning play to finish it. You know, it was definitely surreal, like I said, and, you know, I'm proud of him.
Any other questions for the student athletes? Well, in the front, right here, Nick.
Faxon Childress, 105.5 The Roar. This is for Chase. Chase, we're both Atlanta natives. Can you talk a little bit about just the magnitude behind what it means for the city? Saw you post on Instagram, a lot of people in the comments, obviously. Yep. And then back home, everybody's showing love. Just talk a little bit about Atlanta and what it means to the city.
It means a lot. You know, a lot of players on our team are from Atlanta. I think I was kind of one of the first guys to start that pipeline. And, you know, a lot of good guys have come to this team, you know, and have made a big impact, you know, for us to be putting on for the city, it means a lot. You know, I think that we all want to keep going and make more history. But, you know, we're all proud. I'm proud of these guys that are from Atlanta on this team that have been making impacts in games and stuff like that. But, yeah, we're definitely proud. And, you know, we're going to keep putting on for the city for sure.
We'll go back to the fourth row next.
Hey, Coach. Obviously, this is the first time you're in the Elite Eight since the 79-80 team. You've been around Clemson for so long. Has anyone from that team spoke to you about this moment? Obviously, Larry Nance was on that team. Has anyone from back then talked to you about playing in this game?
Nobody from that team. Certainly a lot of former players, some that I coached recently in the last, you know, 10, 12, 14 years or whatnot. But then some other guys that are much older are certainly very proud. And, you know, it's a great moment for our program. Certainly we want to keep going. But, yeah, taking these kinds of steps are big ones. We know that. And I think our alumni are very proud of what this team is about, both on and off the court.
Do we have any questions for the student athletes here in the room? All right, we're going to go to Zoom here. AP Stedham.
Yes, AP Stedham of AP and Kelly, as we see at Syndicated Radio. This question is for Chase. Chase, what are the difficulties guarding someone like Mark Sears, and maybe how has he grown throughout the season since the last time that you competed against him?
Yeah, definitely a great player, you know, someone who can create plays for himself and create plays for his teammates. I think the big thing for me is just going to be making sure I make things hard for him, you know, not letting him get easy looks early. And, Yeah, just crowding him, you know, like I've been doing the whole season with other good guards that I've played. But, yeah, he's a great player, like I said. And, you know, I haven't really watched much since we played him. But, yeah, we've dug into some film. But, yeah, like I said, I'm just going to make it hard for him and, you know, play as hard as I can on defense.
Do we have any other questions for the student athletes over there?
This is for the three of y'all. Hopefully you guys, this is Merrillman with TigerNet, by the way. Hopefully you guys have seen the footage of downtown Clemson last night. People just running wild in the streets and Little John like blowing the roof off of that. What sort of energy does that give you guys for tomorrow, knowing that everybody back home is just absolutely losing it over this victory?
I mean, you know, it's really exciting just to see how much people really care about the way things are going for us in this program right now. And obviously, everybody always talks about Clemson football and how, you know, big their support is, and to know that we're getting a lot of that right now, it feels great. And, you know, Coach Barnell's built this program up, and, you know, having the grip hit, Little John, all that kind of stuff, and those people there to have support throughout all these years and throughout this run right now is unbelievable. So gives us another juice of energy to kind of have in the back of our minds to do it for them, and hopefully keep this run rolling.
Any other questions for the student athletes? We got one. Go ahead.
This is for all three of you. PJ, you talked about talking with us, with your sports psychologist that's here with us. All right, so my guess is that he's asked you to see the moment, that he's asking you to look ahead and see yourself doing good things. So for the three of you, what are you all envisioning in your heads? What are you envisioning in your heads tomorrow against Alabama and how you see it kind of playing out?
I'm a big kind of think ahead type person. Like whenever I know an event's coming up, I'm trying to get too far ahead, but whenever I know a big game is, you know, coming up, I'm thinking about the possible plays within the play. But at the same time, like, you also got to be able to live in the moment and not get ahead of yourself. Like, one of my favorite things about the Michael Jordan documentary, The Last Dance, is that he had what so many people don't have, Michael Jordan's, where he was present at all times. He was always right in his feet, in his footsteps, you know, right there in the moment. And so being able to sit and keep your nerves calm and relax and know that, you know, don't get ahead of yourself, going to these games with calm nerves, go out there and perform, that's a huge thing for me as well.
Yeah, I think PJ said it well, you know, just don't get too ahead of yourself, you know, just live in the moment and, you know, realize where we're at. You know, we're in Elite Eight in a big game. You know, to go to the Final Four and to make history for Clemson, that would be everything. But, you know, right now we still have to play the game. And so, you know, for us, it's just going in with the same mindset we've gone into every game past. And, you know, when we do that, then we'll be able to say that we're in the Final Four.
Yeah, I'd agree with both those guys, you know, in different aspects. But I like to just kind of be where I'm at, obviously, not look too far ahead, because that's when you can kind of get tripped up. I think, you know, honestly, if you want to look at our season, you know, we probably had a few of those moments where, you know, in the middle of the season, we're, you know, on an all-time high running and might have looked too far ahead and, you know, got tripped up by some games where maybe we shouldn't have or couldn't have. So, I mean, just try and live in the moment, because this doesn't come every, you know, every year. This is my fifth year of college basketball and the first time I'm playing in the Elite Eight. So you just got to live in the moment, be appreciative of where you are, but at the same time, know the magnitude of it and give it your all.
All right, there you go. That's the mostly players, a little bit of Brownell. Just going to run too long here into the top of the hour. So we'll have all that up for you later on our website, sportstalksc.com. Chris, by the way, the USC women in a dogfight now, 74-70, a minute 25 to go. Chris, what's happened in this game?
Third quarter, and ever since, Indiana has lit the fire offensively, and they've just cut it to two now. Ooh. They've hit seven threes here in the second half. I was joking earlier, the only way they might get back in is to hit 10 in the second half. They're getting awfully close. They're getting good looks at the basket, and I think maybe some of that pressure now as the overall number one seed might be catching up a little bit with the Gamecocks. You know how these tournament games go. Mm-hmm. Late, if the underdog is in it, the fans start pulling for the underdog. And so my guess is the majority of the crowd now is on Indiana's side. And to the Hoosiers' credit, boy, they have made some kind of run to cut it down to two with a minute to play.
Yeah, they've outscored the Gamecocks 40-25 in the second half. They are shooting in the fourth quarter 60%. They're 6 of 10. Gamecocks at 44%. So this got a lot more interesting than you thought. Mm-hmm. Back to Clemson. I got to believe at this stage of the tournament, well, I guess I'd have to consider all the other players that are at this point, but you got to consider Chase Hunter as one of the strong candidates for MVP of the tournament. Now, they won't do it. They'll have a Final Four MVP. They won't have a tournament-wide MVP. But certainly, he has been the guy that has kept this team glued together in the tough spots, and has hit the mega baskets for them in the last two games where things got tense.
Had 18 last night, got other players involved, didn't hit a three, which is unusual for him, but had five assists, Phil. And I think he took that poor performance against Boston College in the ACC tournament like the entire team did. I think he took it personally. And they have come out and played some extremely good basketball ever since. And they really sound like a tight team that's out of its element, don't they? They're cool. It sounds like they're talking about a game in December against South Carolina State.
Yeah.
No offense to the Bulldogs, but yeah, the magnitude does not seem to be too big for them.
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. And I think that really comes from their head coach, who never seems to get too ruffled one way or the other. I think I've seen more excitement out of him on the sidelines here in this tournament, especially as they got past that first game and then he realized they're going to beat Baylor. I mean, last night he was stomping up and down the sidelines, directing more excitement from him than I think I've ever seen.
I would agree. He's really gotten into it. And I think he's done a terrific job. He's been brilliant coaching them thus far. And if there were a coaching MVP in the tournament, he'd certainly be one of the candidates for sure.
No question. As we go to break, 76-74, USC women leading Indiana, 23 seconds to go, and we'll be back.
XL Columbia W264DF.
Grills, outdoor kitchens, and fireplaces. Spring sizzle starts with Bart.
This is 107 The Point.
News this hour from townhall.com. I'm Jason Walker. Russian journalists have been detained, Norman Hall reports.
Authorities in Russia have detained six journalists across the country this month, including a journalist who covered the trials of Russian opposition politician Alexei Navalny for several years. Navalny died in an Arctic penal colony in February. The detentions were revealed by media freedom organization Reporters Without Borders. Antonia Favoriskaya was reportedly detained and accused by Russian authorities of taking part in an extremist organization for her social media post. Two other journalists were temporarily detained after they came to meet Favoriskaya in the detention center where she was being held. I'm Norman Hall.
Also at townhall.com, France now calling on some four dozen countries around the world to help supply more than 2,000 additional police officers, that to help secure the Paris Olympics this summer. More from correspondent Charles de Ledesma.
Organizers are finalizing planning for the July 26, August 11 Games, the French capital's first in a century, while on heightened alert against potential attacks. The Interior Ministry says the request for foreign security assistance was made in January. Extras are needed for both games security and what it calls the spectator experience, adding such assistance is a common practice for major international events. Separately, the French Defense Ministry has also asked foreign nations for small numbers of military personnel who could help with tasks including sniffer dog teams. I'm Charles de Ledesma.
New York City officials announcing a pilot program to deploy portable gun scanners in the subway. Now, Mayor Eric Adams says scanners will be introduced in certain stations after a legally mandated 90-day waiting period. The mayor says the city will perform its own analysis of the scanner's accuracy. More on these stories at townhall.com.
If you're paid for by America First Tax Group, attention, if you or your business is behind in filing your tax returns, or if you owe over $10,000 in back taxes to the IRS, please listen carefully. The IRS does not joke around and will not stop their collection efforts. If you're tired of the IRS letters, levies, liens, or wage garnishments and would like to get a fresh start, we can help. Due to the financial hardships in the country, the IRS is making it easier than ever to settle tax problems for those who owe more than $10,000. We can help settle your delinquent tax problems, end all collections, and may even reduce your back taxes significantly. Even if you can't afford to pay your back taxes, you can still get the help you need. We've helped thousands of taxpayers just like you, but you must call 800-391-8718 today to stop your tax problem from getting worse. The information is free, and the help is real. Call 800-391-8718. That's 800-391-8718. Again, 800-391-8718.
Five.
State of Georgia could join other states in requiring youngsters under the age of 16 to have their parents' permission to create social media accounts. Lawmakers have given final approval to a measure that would ban social media use on school devices and internet services as well. It would also require pornography sites to verify that users are at least 18 years of age. New video has been released of a shootout between campus police and a gunman that ended a deadly rampage last December at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. Footage shows police officers aiding a badly wounded professor who walked out of a building. That man survived, but officials say three other professors who were in the building died shortly before the gunman was killed by officers. Breaking news and analysis, townhall.com.
On Point Weather is made possible by our friends at Palmetto Citizens Federal Credit Union on 107 The Point.
Here's our weekend forecast. You can't ask for much nicer than this. Clear and cool tonight with a low of 48. Tomorrow, really nice. Mostly sunny skies, a temperature climbing to 79. For Sunday, hunt those Easter eggs. 83 as our high and a blend of sunshine and clouds. Looking ahead, we're dry until Wednesday of next week. Have a great weekend. I'm Cal Moss with your On Point local weather.
WQXL Columbia, W264DF.
Grills, outdoor kitchens, and fireplaces. Spring sizzle starts with Bart.
This is 107.
Please press button now. No, number one.
Welcome back to Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network. You can reach the guys with the South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number, 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now back to Phil and Chris with a second hour of Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network.
All right, the USC women trying to hold on against Indiana. 14 seconds to go, 79-75. The Gamecocks leading. They've hit five of their last seven to fight off this charge by Indiana. The Gamecocks had a lead. Largest lead for them was 22 points with 7:30 to go, 56-34. Obviously, Indiana
has
made Indiana's made a very strong charge. It's probably going to come up a little bit short. So the USC women are most likely going to advance to play Oregon State in the Elite Eight. Sunday. They play on Sunday. Thank you very much.
It's probably the most unathletic basketball team I think I've ever seen.
Who's that?
I watched that Oregon State Notre Dame game earlier today, and they turned it over. I think it was 22 or 23 times. Their minus 21 turnover margin in a game tied for the largest, I think, in NCAA tournament history for a team that won a game.
Mm.
They are not very athletic. And if the Gamecocks survive today, you certainly would like their chances on Sunday.
Yeah. All right. Hang on just a second here. We're going to get to Mike Morgan in just a moment. As we bring Mike on, we tell you that Mike is brought to you by State Farm agent Gary Patterson. For 35 years, he's been the real estate man for your needs from Lugoff to Lexington, Columbia to Blythewood. Auto, home, life insurance, business insurance can all be handled by Gary. He spends countless hours helping South Carolinians with all their insurance needs and making a difference in the community. Go check out GaryPatterson.net today, and Gary will go over the best plans for you and your family. That's GaryPatterson.net.
Brought to you by Love Chevy. Act now for spectacular savings on the best selection of new Chevys. I-26 at Harbison and at LoveChevy.com. Together, let's drive.
And as we welcome in Mike Morgan, we tell you the Gamecocks have defeated Indiana 79-75 to advance to the Elite Eight. We bring Mike Morgan on. He's one of our Elite Eight on Sports Talk. He's not quite Final Four material, but he is Elite Eight material. Welcome in, Mike. How are you?
I like to think of myself as NIT Final Four material. Since I got to call two NIT championships, just call me NIT Final Four, Mike.
That's good. Hey, as Uncle Dave told us, it's not the national championship, but it is a national championship, and we'll take
it. That's right. Now, hey, I've got the rings to prove it, baby.
Yeah, but can you find the trophies anywhere on this campus?
I don't know. That's a great question. The banners are up, right? They didn't remove the banners.
They do have the banners. I think the trophies are being used as a doorstop in Don Staley's office.
Oh, no. Yeah. Shut your mouth. That is heresy to try and defame an NIT championship. And I won't stand for it. I'll sit for it, but I won't stand for it.
Do you remember your great call at the end of the – was it the second one where they hit the shot at the buzzer?
Yeah, the first one. Mm. They every now and then the guys on inside the Gamecocks, they'll play that call. I remember it very well. It was because when St. Joe's hit the shot to either go up or tie it, I thought maybe there were precious seconds left. I thought Dave would call a timeout. And so I was waiting for that to happen. Well, he decided not to. As some coaches do, you know, the school of thought is if you call a timeout, it helps you get organized. It also helps them set up their defense. So he did not call timeout. And I remember saying, Dave's going to let him play. And then I called Kinsey dribbling up the floor and Kinsey for three. And then it was just it was very simple. I basically said one word, yes, but I said it in a way that I think Matt met the moment and Casey Manning said the same thing. The funny thing about that was I remember shortly thereafter doing some of the coaches shows and then the following year doing more of the coaches shows. And who could forget the Dave Odom TV show? That's instant TV entertainment. But Wendy's had a commercial, and I'm sure this wasn't national. I'm sure it was just a regional spot. But they were, I don't know, talking about their Biggie fries and their hamburger, and they would play that call on the commercial. And somebody asked me, like, how much money are you getting off that every time they play it?
Yeah.
And I said, not a dime, which is 100% true. I never got a penny for that. I thought it was cool if they were playing my call on a TV commercial. But, no, you don't get royalties for that. At least I did.
Yeah. But I'm sure when you walk on campus and Gamecock fans meet you that they thank you for helping bring home those two NIT championships.
You know what? In all seriousness, the first one, I think the fans really got behind. Dave got that team made it to the NCAA tournament in 2004, lost in the first round.
Yep.
And then the following year, it was basically the same team, minus Mike Boynton. Everybody else was back. Kelly, Balkman, Kinsey, Wallace. And while it was disappointing not to make the big field, the run of the NIT, and I think you've covered a couple of these at Madison Square Garden.
I was at both of them.
Yeah, I mean, it's really an awesome experience. This year, they're not doing that. You know, they're going to Hinkle Fieldhouse, which is also a cool spot.
Because they've been in Las Vegas the last couple of years.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. They're going to Hinkle this year, which I also think is awesome. I've been to Hinkle. But no, to go to MSG, I called all those games from where Marv Albert would call Knicks games, which is not right front court and center like you normally see us. It's about 10 rows back. It's an incredible view. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm like, this is where Marv Albert called Knicks games for 30, 40 years. This is a pretty cool deal. And when we got back, there were a ton of Gamecock fans to meet the plane at Eagle Aviation. Well, they weren't really there to see the plane. They were there to see the team.
Mm.
But the plane was kind of a necessary evil to get the team there. And it was people were elated. Now, the second NIT run, that's when people were like, this team is too damn good to be in another NIT. They should be in the big dance. And they were right. They should have been. That was a Sweet 16 caliber team, if not better. But for whatever reason, they did not get over the hump. They struggled in February. So, yes, it was a back-to-back. The first one was a lot of fun. The second one, quite honestly, not nearly as memorable.
Let's face it, Phil, the three of us are probably the only three people in the state that remember that the Gamecocks won two national NIT championships.
All right, look, we got about 5 minutes with you before we have to move on. So let's talk about Clemson, Alabama. I know you're familiar with both teams, having seen them over the last couple of years. What about this matchup, strengths, weaknesses? What do you think?
Let me first off say congratulations. I mean, every time Clemson comes up on your show, it seems like the phrase Brad Brownell on a hot seat comes up, which I think is comical. And I've said so on your show many times. Like, you're not going to do better than what he has done. And I felt that way before the landmark victory the other night against Arizona. And also, P.J. Hall, like, that's what college basketball used to be all about, right? Like a four-year guy who paid his dues, got better every year, and is now reaping some of the rewards, and Chase Hunter and guys like that. I mean, they're actually a good story. I think the Alabama game is very intriguing. You know, you're talking about two programs that have never been to a Final Four in basketball. Obviously, that's going to change. And Alabama was never the best team in the SEC this year. They're still standing. Clemson was never the best team in the ACC this year. They're still standing. So, and North Carolina's not. And, you know, some of the heavyweights in the SEC are not. So that's the beauty of March. I think it'll be a very intriguing game. I mean, by now people know Alabama's MO, right? They're going to shoot a lot of threes. They're going to score a lot of points. They're going to give up a lot of points. If Clemson can keep it a lower scoring game and can turn it into more of a half court game, I definitely would favor Clemson. But now that's easier said than done. A lot of teams try and do that. Alabama is masterful at speeding you up, whether you want it to be that way or not.
Go ahead, Chris. You have a question for Mike.
I do. I was going to follow up on that exact point, Mike, about Clemson and Alabama. I think the way Clemson plays is sort of Alabama's kryptonite. North Carolina seemed to fit their MO because North Carolina, on occasion, doesn't really want to play a whole lot of defense, and we know Alabama plays zero defense. A Clemson team that's as patient as they can be on offense and also pretty stout defensively, can they take that same formula from when they beat them back earlier this season, back in November, where they shot 53% from the field and obviously held Alabama to 34% from the floor? I mean, that would be the recipe, right? Can they do that again, though?
I don't know. I mean, I think Alabama certainly is, you know, anybody that gets to the Elite Eight is feeling pretty good about themselves, right? Because you have to win three games to get to that point, and chances are you probably pulled off an upset if you're a four seed or a six seed. As these two, well, I'm sorry, what is Clemson? Clemson was
six.
A six seed in the ACC.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. They were a six in the ACC tournament as well, right? So, I mean, you know, both these teams have already pulled off their big upset to get to this point. I think it's, I don't know what the point spread's going to be, but in my eyes, it's almost a virtual, you know, pick 'em game. Colin Sears is a really special guard that's very hard to stay behind. You know, with all the talk about the threes, the best part about his game is he can blow by anybody on the floor. So who defensively for Clemson is going to slow him down? He was right up there with the leading scorers in the SEC all year long. He's a really dangerous guard that could score on all three levels. So that would be the biggest matchup concern. Because I think Clemson with Hall and some of their other bigs, they're okay in the front court against Alabama. I think the game comes down to the guards, and that'll be the best guard for Alabama that you'll see.
All right, give us your Final Four. Who's coming out this weekend headed to Phoenix?
Well, so three of my four are still alive. I did pick Duke in an upset. I have Duke beating Houston. That was kind of one of my bigger upsets. I have Tennessee, and I have Connecticut. You know, winning the national championship, which, as boring as that pick is, that's who I have. So I've got three of my four left, and we'll see how it goes. I think it's been an immensely entertaining tournament again. And I think it'll continue to be that way. I'm looking forward to these matchups the next 3 days.
So who is the one slot you have yet to fill with your Final Four? Who do you like?
Well, no. That slot's already been eliminated.
Yeah, but I mean,
in other words, I already lost.
So you're going with UConn, Tennessee, and Duke. That's three of them.
Correct.
Yeah.
So you want me to pick somebody?
This game tomorrow.
Well, it would be either Clemson or Alabama, right? Who did you pick, Phil?
Oh, I picked Clemson to win the whole thing. Way back.
That takes great bravery and courage to do that.
I actually picked the Tigers, but it was the Auburn Tigers to win the national championship.
Oh, well, that went well. I'll leave it at that. I honestly think Clemson-Alabama is a pick'em game, and it really – tempo will determine it. I don't think Clemson wants this game in the 80s, and I know Alabama doesn't want this game in the 60s. So where is it going to go? Is it going to be somewhere in the middle? If so, it's going to be truly a last-second type of game, I believe. If it's low-scoring, Clemson's going to a Final Four. If it's really high-scoring, fast-paced, then I think Alabama will cut down the nets.
Mike, appreciate it. Have a great weekend. Have a great Easter, and we'll talk to you next week.
Appreciate you, Mike.
Thank you guys on all fronts. Really enjoyed it, and we'll talk to you next week.
Our pleasure, bud. Talk to you next week. All right, Mike Morgan. USC women win 79-75. Clemson leads Miami 2-0, bottom of the first, over top. Got the runs in for the Tigers. USC, Alabama, scoreless top of the second. Coastal leads ULM 3-0 after one. College of Charleston beats Stony Brook 11-5. Be right back.
This is Major Billy Downer with the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources. Boating season is here, and as you get ready to go out on the water this spring and summer, make sure you have all the required safety equipment on board. Check for a sound device. A horn or whistle will suffice for most boats. Inspect all of your life jackets. Make sure they're in good condition and are the correct size for all of your passengers. If your boat is over 16 feet, you will need to make sure you have an approved throwable device on board as well. Remember, boating safety is no accident.
Relax with an auto loan from Founders Federal Credit Union. Here at Founders, we understand that it's more than just a vehicle. It's a part of your life's journey, from hobbies changing to families growing. It's with you along the way. Our low fixed rates can get you on the road in a ride that fits your life. Not sure what you want? Apply early for a pre-approved spending limit so you know what to look for before you start shopping. Head over to one of our 41 convenient office locations or visit foundersfcu.com to apply for an auto loan today. Federally insured by NCUA. Membership qualification required. Terms and conditions apply.
You're listening to Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network. We're back in a moment.
Call Lawyer Lisa. Experience the difference with Lawyer Lisa.
Hi, I'm Lisa Hosteller Brown. Did you know it's possible to avoid probate court after you die, regardless of what you own? Why put your loved ones through a long, stressful public process when there are better options for your family? Visit lawyerlisa.com to see how we can help.
Call Lawyer Lisa. Experience the difference with Lawyer Lisa.
7511 St. Andrews Road, Irmo, South Carolina.
You've put in the work for your education. The extra early, extra late, extra, extra work. That's because you understand education opens doors to better pay, better opportunities, and a better you. Being educated about playing the lottery is no different. It helps you be a better player, one who knows when to play and when to take a rain check. The lottery's a game, so let's keep it fun. Learn more at sceducationlottery.com/betteryou.
Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing, boys. Racing, boys. Chris, let me hear you. Let's go racing, boys.
I'm boycotting.
Why?
They should not run on Easter Sunday.
Oh, you've always been against that.
Great traditions in NASCAR, and we're going to run on Easter Sunday. Come on.
You gotta
Come on,
be
NASCAR. Be better.
You got to be a Debbie Downer. Let's welcome in Jeff Owens in the fast lane.
Jeff agrees.
Whether we like it or not, Jeff, they are racing this weekend at Richmond.
I agree with Chris. It's an absolute travesty.
Love you, Jeff.
In all seriousness, I don't like it. I didn't like it when they did it at Bristol. It was a sort of sacred tradition for years, and they stopped that a few years ago to run the Bristol Dirt Race, and now we're actually, you know, didn't even realize that till I looked it up, but it's Sunday night, and you know, I guess that's better than Sunday afternoon. But I agree, I don't really like racing on Easter Sunday.
What forced their hand on this, television or just the number of races that they have to squeeze in?
I think it's the number of races. They're trying to minimize, well, not minimize, but you only got a few off weeks of the year. And, yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, they run so many races and you can't fit them all in and you almost can't take a week off. But they used to skip, you know, Mother's Day weekend and Easter, and those used to be the most sacred weekends of the year. But, yeah, I mean, the schedule's so long that you don't have any off weeks, and they try to space them out. And, you know, they try to do them, you know, where, you know, they're on – give them a break after long road trips and stuff like that. And, you know, it just doesn't work out with Easter weekend. So we're having a race. And, you know, at least we're not running the Bristol Night Race or the Bristol Dirt Race, you know, and we got a good venue. Should be a great race at Richmond. And maybe, you know, maybe it works out. Maybe it starts a nice tradition or something. But, yeah, I'm not crazy about them doing it this Sunday. But here we go.
Yeah, you're right. I think we'll have a great race. I mean, Richmond pretty much always delivers a great race and also usually delivers some moves that leads to anger and conversations and maybe more than that. You know, a guy gets turned, a guy takes the lead, he punts a guy into the wall, that sort of stuff. So I imagine we can expect more of the same Sunday night.
Yeah, there's always some dust-ups at Richmond, no question about it. You know, all your short tracks sort of lend itself to that. And, yeah, I'm encouraged by the fact that we saw a really, really good short track race at Bristol a couple weeks ago. And hopefully they could produce the same thing this weekend. I'm interested to see. And I really don't know this information. I should know this, but I don't know what kind of tire they're bringing. You know, that was the big deal at Bristol. You know, they brought a softer tire. The tires wore out, and it made for some great racing. I'd love to see that happen again at Richmond. But, you know, the thing about Richmond, you know, it's a short track, but it's also wide enough that you can run three wide there, and you can pass in inside, outside. So that lends for some good side-by-side racing. And as a result of that, we do have some dust-ups and some drama now and then. So I think it should be an exciting race.
Jeff Owens in the fast lane with us here tonight on Sports Talk. Jeff, I saw a fascinating stat a bit earlier about NASCAR. There has not been an overtime race thus far this season, and it's just the second time since 2004 that has occurred. As a matter of fact, if you go back to last year, the last nine Cup races have not gone into overtime. As tight as some of these races are, and I would anticipate perhaps we'll have another close finish at Richmond on Sunday night, is there an explanation that you can come up with as to why they have been able to stay out of trouble the last couple of laps of every race?
Yeah, you know, I think it's just circumstances. You know, and we've had some races, you know, with the exception of Daytona. And I thought Daytona might have ended in overtime. Maybe they didn't. I can't recall. But, you know, after Daytona, we've had some races. Atlanta was great. But the last three events, it's been a situation where the leader has sort of gotten away a little bit. And, you know, you just didn't have anything happen behind them. You know, it wasn't really close to the front. And, you know, it's all circumstances. You know, it depends on whether you have a wreck or caution. And sometimes it happens and sometimes it doesn't. But that is kind of a remarkable streak for them to go that long to not have an overtime race. I'd say there's a good chance we have one this weekend.
That would be my guess. Is there a reason, and I guess it boils down to the Chevys and Toyotas have just been better, but is there a reason in your mind that Ford has struggled as much as it has here in the early portion of the year?
Yeah, I just got to think that these teams haven't gotten a handle on the new car yet. You know, Ford and Toyota both came out with new models this season. It seems like Toyota was on their top of their game from the very beginning. We saw the Fords really fast at Daytona,
right,
in qualifying and stuff like that, but it hasn't translated over to the track. And you got a couple, you know, Joey Logano, you know, not having a good season so far, and he's usually your top Ford driver. Blaney's doing okay, but I just think it's got to be that. They haven't really quite gotten a handle on the setups for this new car yet, and it may take them a few more weeks to iron that out.
All right, so we look ahead. Kyle Busch, 6 wins. I guess he's got the most wins of the active drivers. Denny Hamlin has 4. It's his home track. He's always like a favorite there at Richmond. You know, Busch wasn't happy at COTA after last weekend's events, after he got, cut down on, is what he was arguing about. So what do you think here? I think it's been a little while since he got a win. So is he getting closer? Is this going to be a good opportunity for him or somebody else?
Yeah, I think he'll be up there. As long as, you know, he keep the car under him and the pit crew doesn't, you know, mess up on him. That's been the situation with Kyle. He's been pretty fast, but they seem like they make a mistake on pit road every week. They've already changed their pit crew once this year. So I think they got to figure out that piece of it. But he'll certainly be a contender. So will Denny Hamlin. And watch Martin Truex. He's got 3 wins there, I think, in the last maybe 6 races or so. And the way the Toyotas have been running this year, those are the 2 guys I would watch, Hamlin and Truex. They'll be up there. Keselowski's good at that track too, so we'll see if the Fords can finally figure it out. But I like Hamlin and Truex, and I'd certainly throw Kyle Busch into that mix as well.
Look forward to it. Listen, we appreciate you as always. Have a great Easter weekend. Force yourself to watch some racing and some baseball and some basketball and some UFL if you want to dive into that as well. Oh, my. And we'll talk to you next week, my friend. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thanks, Jeff.
All right, guys. Have a good one.
Have a great one. That's Jeff Owens in the Fast Lane here.
Smart guy. Oh, such a smart guy.
Fantastic guy. Okay, let's catch up on the golf scene. Got a lot of college golf going on. George Bryan has a special guest coming up. Birdies, bogeys, biceps, up next on Sports Talk.
On Point Weather is made possible by our friends at Palmetto Citizens Federal Credit Union on 107 The Point.
Here's our weekend forecast. You can't ask for much nicer than this. Clear and cool tonight with a low of 48. Tomorrow, really nice. Mostly sunny skies, a temperature climbing to 79. For Sunday, hunt those Easter eggs. 83 as our high and a blend of sunshine and clouds. Looking ahead, we're dry until Wednesday of next week. Have a great weekend. I'm Gal Moss with your Odd Point local weather.
If you spend as much time in your outdoor living space as I do, you should make that time truly enjoyable with new patio furniture and a new grill from Jack Oliver's Pool Spa and Patio. We offer a huge selection of high-quality, unique, brand-name patio sets, pieces, and accessories. Our top-of-the-line grills include Big Green Egg, Weber, and Traeger. It's all in stock and online at affordable prices at Jack Oliver's Pool Spa and Patio, Forest Drive and jackoliverpools.com.
With SRN News, I'm Jason Walker. New York State police say 2 men from Senegal froze to death and were found in the snow close to the Canadian border. The bodies were found earlier in the week during a routine patrol. Both men said to be about 25 years of age. In South Africa, a bus carrying worshipers to an Easter weekend church gathering plunging off a bridge on a mountain pass then burst into flames. The police say at least 45 people have been killed. Georgia could be joining other states in requiring children younger than the age of 16 to have their parents' permission to create social media accounts. Lawmakers have given final approval to a measure that would also ban social media use on school devices. Wall Street closed today because of Good Friday. This is SRN News.
Every month you get a power bill, and every time you look at it, you realize you have very little control of that bill. If you want to take some control, it's time to reach out and talk to the folks at Broker Solar. Listen, solar power is not for everyone. It is a commitment, but the rewards are well worth it, not because of the politicians and the media and the green this and the green that and that. It's worth it because it'll save you money on the long term. It'll give you control of your power bill, and there are some great tax advantages available. But you know what? You need to do your homework. Don't get fooled by the guy putting lawn signs in the grass offering something too good to be true. I have known the owners of Booker Solar for more than 20 years. I trust Ken and his team, and I believe you should too. They are local. They are legitimate. I've been to multiple homes where they've installed solar power. The technology is phenomenal, and I am a believer. See for yourself. Online, it's brokersolar.com, or call Ken at 807-7417. That's 807-7417. It's Broker Solar.
Do you like trivia? Do you like pizza? You're going to love Thursday night at the Mellow Mushroom Pizza Bakers. That's right. Mellow in the Vista and on Sunset in Lexington have live-hosted team trivia every Thursday night starting at 7. Trivia buffs of all ages can compete for Mellow cash and swag in our fun and funky digs while enjoying specials on amazing pizzas, apps, sandwiches, salads, and over 100 beers from around the world. You've still got your long-term memory. Use it at the Mellow Mushroom every Thursday in the Vista and on Sunset in Lexington.
The World returns to the State Fairgrounds April 6th and 7th for the 29th year of the Columbia International Festival. Experience South Carolina's cultural diversity. Explore 100 national exhibits. Taste foods from around the world and shop at an international bazaar. Enjoy cultural performances, fashion shows, and a parade of nations. This year highlights the Caribbean. For more information, visit CIFonline.org.
Hey, honey, I know you're taking some meds for cholesterol. I was reading that if you're on these medicines, you should also be taking some CoQ10.
Actually, our pharmacist mentioned that to me already. He called me the other day, and we went through each of our medications together.
Really? He called you?
Yeah, he asked if I was having any side effects, recommended supplements that could help me, and let me know the risk of mixing certain drugs.
Wow, I'm happy to know that True Pharmacy is thinking about us.
True Pharmacy, 1628 Charleston Highway, 3217 Divine Street, or visit truerxsc.com.
Step into a world of comfortable living with Lexington Discount Homes. For over three decades, we've dedicated ourselves to helping families find their dream home. Our steadfast commitment to customer service and our broad range of homes ensure a fit for every taste and budget. Experience the stunning detail of a Lexington home in person at 1847 Augusta Highway. Too busy? Visit LexingtonDiscountHomes.com for a virtual tour. For homes that spell absolute comfort, you know where to find us. Lexington Discount Homes.
Four! Straight down the middle. It went straight down the middle. Then it started to hook just a wee bit. And that's when my caddy lost sight of it. That little white pellet has never been found to this day.
But all right. You know, we turn the calendar to April. Monday. Some of you think that means baseball season. Some of you think that means Final Four. Some of you think that means the heart of NASCAR. But most of us think the Masters. That's right. The Masters and the RBC Heritage coming up in April. Going to be all over it here on Sports Talk and Birdies, Bogeys, and Biceps brought to you by Tsunami Bar Sports. We welcome George Bryan III to Sports Talk once again. Good evening, George. How are you?
Oh, couldn't be better. And this is truly, this is like Christmas season to me. And you mentioned, ain't America great because we can enjoy it all from NASCAR to baseball, March Madness at I guess basketball goes into June now if you want to. Depends on which league you follow.
Yep.
And we just do it all. And Tsunami Bar Sports, now we can do it all. And this is a breakout Friday night on this March 29th. I guess that's the date. Is it still the 29th?
It's still the 29th, George. It's still the 29th.
Yep. And Tsunami Bar Sports, well, we start telling the real story. Our technology, the company's been around, 8 years. Started just strictly with a product, called the Tsunami Bar, which is bendable bar technology. And it was invented in the Clemson weight room. And the industrial strength sports know quite a bit about it. The golf, I'd call it Olympic sports. Well, it's creeping along. And we have a very special guest on tonight who is truly not just a wonderful human being, but he is what I call, in golf terms, he's a real stud, Phil. Mm. And we talked about him. We have talked about him. He is a real golf stud. And he is going to join us here in a bit. I know he's probably laughing. He's not mic'd up just yet. We're not bringing him up just yet because we're going to talk a little bit about that, what's going on with Tsunami Bar Sports. We have now a scramble course, 6-hole chip and putt. We also, this course is artificial turf, so it stays in mint condition, 365, 24 hours a day. It's use a blower, and it is wonderful putting surface and quite the challenging. We call it the scramble course. So we also have simulators. Anybody out there listening wanting a backyard green? How about indoor training studio? We have design build capacity for not just indoor golf training studio, but weight rooms. In fact, I was in the new William Strength Garage Gym Pro Shop and noticed in the Cayman Islands, we have a garage gym. You'll be able to visit our pro shop, I think, in May. It looks ready to me. We'll have to talk with Mike Ramsey and tighten that up. But a whole lot going on with Tsunami Bar Sports. We'll have family golf leagues to announce. Already conducting quietly a local Lexington Recreation and Aging Family Golf League at the Scramble Course. And there will be – here's the cool part. Hmm. We will have youth, senior, adult, ladies, fun golf fitness to fire up this summer. And when you tie fitness with fun and mix in a Tsunami Bar, there's just nothing quite like it. And so, Phil, even since you got started. Mm.
I love my Tsunami Bar.
Hey, and we've got new protocols just invented this week to make it even more fun. And so,
well, I've had the pleasure, like you just mentioned, new ones being made. I've had the pleasure of being there and seeing the bars come out of the oven, literally being cooked right there on the site. and the science and the precision that goes into that's amazing, right? The people that
and Tsunami Robbie
design
Tsunami
that stuff,
Robbie,
yeah.
And so Tsunami Robbie is the one who he touches about every one of the products, and oh man, he loves to make sure that each bar is trimmed and just right. And they literally ship all over the world from right there on 720 Chris Drive, and so there's much more. This is a little bit of, you could tell I left you voicemails this week.
Mm.
Pretty excited about tonight, and there's nobody better than to get us kicked off than Phil Kanders. He's going to – you like talking about the results. Let's get some of that going, get it out of the way so we can bring Phil up right on the backside of that. I'm sure you got it handy right in front.
We'll hit these leaderboards, and then we'll have Phil ready to go with us in just a second. So we've got, of course – leading up to the Masters, we've got the Texas Children's Houston Open, and we have got Tony Finau, 69-62, 9-under. Ashkay Bhatia, 67-68, he's at 5-under.
Hold on, stop. That's Akshay. Bhatia.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know what? I practiced that last time I messed it up, and I messed it up again. Akshay Bhatia.
Akshay. I don't get a chance to correct you. That's the first time in my life.
No, it's not the first time. You do it all the time. And that's why I appreciate you for doing that. I want to be right. Scottie Scheffler, 5-under after a 64. Taylor Moore, 5-under after a 71. Stefan Jaeger, 5-under after a 66. Chad Ramey, a 66. He's at 5-under. Thomas Detry is on the course. He's at 5-under. Got a bunch of 5-unders. Some others that we keep an eye on, Andrew Novak, he's still on the course. He's even for the tournament. And Kevin Kisner, 69-74. He's plus +3. Matt Neesmith is plus +3. He's on the course. Carson Young, plus +8. Saw a little highlight of him. He chipped in for a double bogey. Got some wild reaction from the crowd. I guess they appreciate the fact he didn't give up and he chipped in for a double bogey. He's going to miss the cut at plus +8. Now, college golf. We got the Liz Murphy Collegiate Classic. Usually South Carolina's in this event. They are not this year. College of Charleston is. They're 11th at plus +21 at this point. Auburn leads at minus -3. Looks like Charleston is our only state team in that. And then we've got the Cutter Creek Intercollegiate, which is in North Carolina. We've got Presbyterian and Charleston Southern in this one. Charleston Southern is 6th at plus +5, and Presbyterian is tied for 10th at plus +11. East Carolina is leading at minus -4. So those are some of what we've got going on. And now, George, we're ready to bring in your special guest. So tee it up and take a swing at it.
Oh, what a privilege it is to have Phil Kanders, over 20 years, a very good friend first. And then we have studied the game together. He's a member of the Country Club of Lexington, the husband of Deborah, and he's got children and grandchildren. He's the ultimate granddad, dad, and husband, but a great friend. And so let's go ahead and tee it up. This is, and I just love saying this. He's 82 years old. This guy's got more energy than just about anybody I know. Hmm. And his golf virus is contagious even over the airways. Welcome, Phil Kanders.
Phil Kanders. Good evening, George. Good to see you. Hear you.
Hmm. That's really cool. I hope you're sitting there on the couch, probably watching a little TV, listening to the birds on the porch, maybe, and you teed it up today, Phil. Talk to us. Enjoy the day.
No, I didn't get to play today. I had some things I had to do at home, but we had an 8 o'clock tee time, and I know the guys that I play with did, and from what I heard, they had a pretty good time. So. But no, as George said, I've known George for going on 20 years now. We've studied together for most of those. And the one thing I'll just tell everybody is don't believe much of what George says, because he has an ability to exaggerate, especially when it comes to talking about other people.
This is the truth. I'm just gonna step it up. And from the Phil has been part of the Tsunami Bar Initiative since its inception, in that he's been shoulder to shoulder looking into the product, the different ways we can use it. And so 8 years ago is when he got involved, and we introduced, it was more from a golf, more exercise than what we call golf specific. Would you agree with that, Phil?
Yes, it was pretty much. And at that point, the Tsunami Bar was brand new, so there wasn't much known about it. And there was even less known about how to apply it to any sport, especially golf. So George had to start pretty much from scratch and invent and design things as he went along. And here they are today.
So about 4 years ago, we got real narrow on what we call our golf-specific impact conditioning protocols. And I'll just say for short, impact conditioning is their movements designed specific to influence impact. So, Phil, about 4.5 years ago, you started on these protocols, and just give us a little synopsis of what has happened over the last 4 years. Now, keep in mind, that was at 78 years old. You're now 82. Talk about some stats and the journey you've been on the last 4 years.
Well, as I got older, I like everybody does, I started noticing a great difference in just loss of distance and just in the loss of the quality of the shot, the trajectory, those kinds of things, the distance. And George introduced me to the Tsunami Bar, and I started working with one of the products that they call a mini stick. It's a 48-inch flexible bar, doing some of the impact conditioning exercises. And then George introduced me to another product that they have developed that's called the Laginator. And what that is it's a product that has a grip so you can hold it like you hold a golf club, and it has a sliding weight on it. And the thing that I've used it for, and it's helped me the most, is that it helps you to sequence the movements in your swing so that you get audio feedback when you're applying the maximum force to the golf ball. So between the two of those, as I said, I had been losing distance, and in the last 4 years, I've gotten back probably 10 to 15 yards with a driver and probably a club or club and a half with each iron. So I've used those products as part of a training routine, and I work out at golf twice a week and play three times a week, so I have a lot of exposure to it. And George has been kind enough to guide me through and let me use the facility in White Rock to come out and work out. So overall, pretty well.
And when this is something that at my age, Phil, you got a few years on me. Phil,
I got a few years on you? On the upper side or the lower side?
You and I are about the same, but Phil's got us both.
So oh, that Phil,
don't
yeah.
Really know
yeah.
Don't really know what it might be like 20 years from now in this skin and bones, this whatever I got. But in fact, don't even know if I'll get there. But what I do know is very unusual what's happened to Phil Kanders. When you are 78 and we have these machines that measure speed, trajectory, and his numbers have improved in the last 4 or 5 years. When you're heading on the top side of 80, getting faster, better, not just with the long swing, not just with the driver, but Phil, talk a little bit about what's going on with your pitching and chipping, your form, your technique.
Well, those kinds of things, I can give a lot of credit there to the Laginator, because that again helps you sequence the moves, and it doesn't matter whether you're hitting a 20-yard pitch shot or a 200-yard drive, you can still use that device to practice and get your swing sequenced to where you're applying maximum efficiency to the golf ball, and that's what's helped me the most. Chipping has improved greatly, and with the other things, I'm not so much on score anymore, but just the quality of the shots, the feeling of the contact is so much better than it has been, and I would highly recommend anyone that is serious about the game to try the products and learn how to use them.
Hey, so Phil, hold on just a second. This is a news golf flash from my buddy Randolph. He's reminding me that the Gamecock women are number two, and the SEC women's golf tournament will be at the Pelican down in Tampa. Florida. And so thank you very much, Randolph, for that. And Phil,
yes.
Back to Phil Kanders.
Yes.
With all this improvement, that you have experienced, did you have to go through pain in order to receive such gain, or is it something that's actually kind of fun to practice or work with?
Well, again, I think it depends on your point of view. I love practicing, and I love what I'm doing, so it's not pain at all, but it's not something that you can just come by casually and, you know, think that in a 5 or 10 minute session you're going to get much benefit from it. It takes a while to learn it. Each person is different, and so they're going to have different ways that they can benefit from it.
How often do you utilize the Tsunami Bar training tools?
I would say on average, I use them at least twice when I'm working out, twice a week. I use them every time before I go to play golf to warm up, and that's three more times a week. So probably on an average of 6, maybe 7 times a week, I'll touch one or more of the products.
And where do you do this? Do you do it at the gym? Do you do it at the golf course or at home?
Well, I do it at the golf academy when I'm there. I do it at home before I go to play. And those are the two main places where I practice with the equipment.
Excellent. And it's one of those things, Phil, that we've been talking about the Tsunami Bar. We call them pattern support tools, but they also serve a dual purpose. You can use them for intense exercise training. Most of the golf tools are lightweight. They even fit in the golf bag. The speed sticks, you mentioned the Laginator and the mini stick 47. And it's time to go ahead, Phil. You can give a website code. It's TsunamiBarSports.com, BBB5, and you get 5% off. Go take a look. Cruise that website. You're about to get some more videos, some updated videos. I talked to Patrick earlier. And so, Phil, there are people like – I think Randolph, my buddy Randolph, could be in Tampa picking this up. And he'd be watching or listening – via website, right or wrong.
Correctamundo. Yeah, many ways.
Yeah.
Sir. Website or on X or on Facebook or YouTube. And you're right that you can go to our website and click on the link to Tsunami Bar Sports. And like you mentioned, shop around and place your order and use that code BBB5 and get 5% off, which is a nice little chunk of change to take off that total.
And I tell you, there's nothing quite like this technology out there to help folks explore and find what they do well in the game. And because I see Phil at least once, maybe twice a week, he's made some tremendous discoveries with pitching that actually can bleed vertical into that full swing. Phil, the release. Oh, and I just got another. Here's another news flash from Randolph. He's streaming. So, I get your text, Sue. I'm pretty cool with technology. Yeah, I got 2 minutes. Can 2 minutes hold on to me, Phil Kornblut?
Yes. I think.
So.
I hope.
Yeah. Phil Kanders, you got 30 seconds to describe that feeling, that new feeling and sensation you have with the pitch shot. What's it like?
Well, it feels effortless when you do it right, and the sound is so totally different of just the way the club sounds when it hits the ball. And then you just watch the ball flight, and then watch when the best part is when it hits the green and takes a couple bounces and either stops or backs up a little bit.
Phil Kanders, you have crushed it in the close. Phil Kanders, thank you for joining us. Phil Kornblut,
yes.
I'm going to go ahead and close this down. Mike Ramsey suggested 10 years ago when he introduced me to technology, he goes, George, there's nothing like the feel and how that feel can influence motion. It increases sensitivity and it amplifies feedback. So what you just heard was Phil Kanders just simply described that effortless feeling of hitting a golf shot. And there's nothing like the sound. So, hey, that's how you extract the magic. That's how you reach in and find your individual magic. BBB5, go to that website, Tsunami Bar Sports. Whether you're streaming, watching on the website, hey, Phil Kornblut, it's been a privilege. Great kickoff. Appreciate the opportunity. Until next week, Tim Howe, shoot him luck. Don't forget about the Augusta Amateur we're going to be. I'm going to be calling on Troy Thrall to see if he'll join us maybe Thursday, Friday night for a little update. The Augusta Amateur, Women's Amateur, that's next weekend. So call my buddy Troy and see if he'll join us for an update.
All right, before I let you go, while we're talking about college golf, and that's great, love to have him on. We do have – I failed to mention this. Clemson is playing out in San Francisco in the Goodwin, which I believe is like the largest field of teams in the season at one place. The Tigers are, after two rounds, they are in eighth place. They are plus 10. They're actually playing. They're in their second round. They're plus 10 for the tournament. They're on the backside, and they're in eighth place. Georgia is plus 4. So it's a very tightly bunched field, and the Tigers are still in the hunt. You mentioned the USC women. They got another win earlier in the week when they won the Old Barnwell match play in a tiebreaker with Duke. That's their fourth win of the season. And the USC men were at the Hootie at Bulls Bay, which wrapped up on Tuesday, and they finished fifth at minus 4. So a pretty good finish for them, excuse me, in that event. At minus 4. LSU won it at minus 15. The Gamecocks were minus 4. Of course, remember now, they were playing without their best player, Nathan Franks, because he was injured in that van crash coming off the trip to Georgia Southern. Frankie Harris actually tied for first for the Gamecocks, finishing at minus 6. So he had a good showing for them. So I just wanted to give you that last little bit of college golf news.
Well, that was a great – it just keeps getting better. But the Augusta Women's Amateur next week, that'll be fun to keep up with. Great preview into the number one sports event on planet Earth, the Masters. And we got the drive, chip, and putt that will be kind of a sandwich right in between the two events. So it'll be fun. Hopefully we get Troy Thrall on next week.
Okay.
Jensen Castle. One of his proteges will be playing in the event, and appreciate the time. Phil Kanders, thanks so much for joining us. You crushed it at the very end talking about that pitch shot and how easy it is. And like I said, I've already said it once. Until next week, tee 'em high. Happy Easter, but shoot 'em low.
Thank you, George. Always great having you with us. Yes, sir. Okay, real quick, Alabama has put a 5 spot on the board against the Gamecocks in the third.
Yeah, Dylan Eskew did not survive the third. Yeah. Matthew Becker on in relief.
5-0 going to the fourth, and Clemson is leading at Miami in the bottom of the fourth, 3-1. Chris, have a great Easter weekend, my friend.
Thank you, sir. You guys have a great weekend, too. And watch out for NC State as well, up 13 at the half on Marquette.
Unbelievable.
Talk about getting hot at the right time. Good grief.
Unbelievable. Have a great weekend, and we'll see what happens with Clemson. We'll have it covered on our website, SportsTalkSC.com, and also for the USC women as well over the weekend. And thank you, Josh. Have a great weekend, everybody. Great holiday. See you Monday.
Dropped the first game of the series last night, a walk-off two-run home run, and lead this one by a score of 3-1 just before 8 o'clock here at the ballpark. A beautiful night here in South Florida.